and the lowest paid easy work that I could find. And I also found out another exciting thing about selling. The choice was mine, all mine. By myself, I could make it the highest paid hard work, or I could let it be the lowest paid easy work. I discovered that what I'd achieve in my selling career was entirely up to me, and what anyone else wasn't going to, and what anyone else wanted wasn't going to make much difference. What anyone else would or wouldn't give me wasn't going to make much difference either. The only thing that really mattered was that what I did for myself and what I gave to myself. That's an old selling guru named Tom Hopkins. So you can go in, share widgets, and talk features and benefits of product, and just chip away at competitive business and do different things like that. Or you can allow the vehicle that we've created here for you to get you in the front door and sell like you've never sold before. And having been in that seat, as I said earlier, I know that by Thursday you're like, all right, just shut up. I don't care what the next person says, I'm done, right? I'm on brain overload, I'm done, I'm checked out, just give me the test and get me out of here. give me my flight, right? But I hope that there's a little bit left in the tank, because I'd love for you to really bring into focus as much of your energy as you can and your attention as you can to try to key in on some of the little things we're going to talk about today that can really make a difference in your selling. Again, you can let it be the lowest paid work, or if you put a little effort into learning what we're going to talk about today, it can be the highest paid hard work you'll ever do. So with that said, take you on a little journey. But before we do that, let's talk a little bit about a few things. First and foremost, so again, I've been in that chair. I sold for 3 years. I love selling the repeated product. I mean, this is a great space to be in. No one's flatlining, right? People are just trying to get back to whatever they were doing. For all intents and purposes, you've got really engaged physicians that care about their patients, good staff. It's just kind of a positive, good, feel-good energy division and industry to be in, right? But when an opportunity came in to no longer be the lone wolf, spending 3-4 hours in my car a day, seeing my windshield, and be back on a team and do some work, and I jumped back in and came in and did some product management for a couple of years. And then as the OPS team, the business solution team, was expanding in the West, they'd never had anybody cover the West before, I threw my ring in the hat and started doing that. And that's been almost five years ago now. And I've loved pretty much every minute of it. We get to sell product in a completely different way than what you do, and it's exciting. And if you don't think that you and I aren't aligned, then hopefully you'll come away knowing that we are aligned in trying to sell as much Bragg product as possible in every account that we touch for you. That is what we're trying to do. That is our goal. All right, so business solutions, OPS, orthopedic practice solutions. You've heard these terms used interchangeably. What do you know? What have you heard? Great. It's great. That's correct. I'll take that. Say again.
Helps with compliance. Increased revenue, position, group.
Helps with inventory.
Time management.
Time management. What would you like to know about? Everything that's not on this list? What else would you like to know? Or what are you hoping to learn? Maybe that's a better way to phrase it. What are you hoping to learn today?
How strong the network of insurance coverage is.
How strong, say again?
The network of insurance coverage.
That's interesting, okay. Okay. Anything else?
That's what I sell it to the doctor.
Yeah, what good looks like, right? Anything else you're hoping to learn today?
Why the OPS is the best product out there.
So why is this guy going to get up and talk about this for a couple of hours and take a couple of hours of your life that you're never going to get back, right? That's what you want to know. Ooh. I love it. Great. I think we'll be able to answer that. I hope. No pressure, right? No pressure. So let me take you on a little journey, a little story that I hope you will find interesting and if nothing else, open your eyes up to how can we sell this? You know, what can we learn from this? I think this narrative will really set up a lot of things that we're going to go over today. So it starts back in 1988. A gentleman was hired by a local practice here to be their medical director. And in his former life, he was the head NFL football trainer for the San Diego Chargers. He got that position when he was 27 years old. And if any of you know anything about athletic training, becoming a head anything at 27 is amazing, let alone the NFL. So we're talking about a very talented, hardworking person, this guy. So he'd spent 10 years as head NFL trainer for the Chargers, a little disenfranchised with how the NFL was doing things and a lot of changes going on, and found this other position in this practice here in San Diego as a medical director. This practice represented the team, and they were very busy, very, very busy, but things were not going as well as they'd like. Their reputation wasn't as stellar as they'd like it to be, and a lot of it was really tied to patient outcomes. Because if a patient is satisfied with a service or product, they tell whom?
Doctor.
Everyone.
And if you're not happy with the service or product, who else do you tell?
Everyone.
And even more. And now social media, you know, crazy stuff. So word of mouth in this industry is big, right? It's very, very big. So their patient outcomes were spotty. And a lot of it was tied to their post-operative care. Because they were so reliant on outside vendors to take care of things for them. Do you know what I'm talking about? Oh, I've got my CPM gal that I send all my CPM business to, right? And she and her company take care of everything. I've got my cold therapy guy. He takes care of everything, right? I just send him the person's information and say, you know, get them a cold therapy. We may not have some insurance coverage, and so we're sending out some scripts to other third-party vendors to bring the product to the surgery center and bill the patient on our behalf and just take care of it, right? Scripting it out. They were getting very, very spotty results, very, very spotty service. Sometimes the doc would go to the OR, and the staff, and they're doing the thing, and they're like, where's that product? We got no product. Okay, and then of course, you know, stuff hits the fan, and there's problems, right? Person is being put into a shoulder CPM. The protocol's messed up. They did, you know, 20 or 30 degrees more of external whatever, and now the patient's in pain. All kinds of little things can go wrong in these processes and these things that physicians do working with these outside vendors. Now, you all know that they're selling their services, right, to these practices because they want the prescription. They want the business because they can make money billing the CPM. They can make money on the cold therapy. They can make money on the surgical products. You guys understand this, correct? Okay. But if the service isn't there, there could be problems. And that's where they were. The service wasn't as stellar as they'd like it to be. So this gentleman, Mark Howard, was hired to bring everything in-house that made sense. everything that made sense, he was asked to bring in. They bought knee, shoulder, and ankle CPM machines. They bought a whole bunch of bread cold therapy machines, backup, you know, pumps and the wall chart, the adapters, all of those items. They bought it all, a bunch of pads. They brought in everything that made sense to them, and they started taking care of their own patients. And as Mark defines it and describes it, he says, from every place along the rehab process that we could touch the patient, we wanted to touch the patient. We wanted to be the ones taking care of them. So they did. So if I had an ACL there, I was told way up front that I was going to be getting this product, and I'd be in a CPM, knee CPM. When I woke up in the PACU downstairs from their clinic in the ambulatory surgery center, I would have this on. I would just be going, right? And I was told to bring someone along with me that could help carry it from the PACU to the trunk of the car to the home. And then I was also told that I needed to have somebody help me bring it back at my follow-up appointment at whatever time frame, because then I was going to be done with it. They offered rentals for cold therapy. They offered purchases for cold therapy because the physicians believed in the modality. Got a lot of great feedback. I've seen the great feedback over the years. There's no talk about the wonderful hands that fixed whatever they fixed. It was about that cooling unit. So they set this all up to run like this. And again, they rented them out. A lot of people would rent them and then be like, you know, I want to buy it. And then they'd sell them a brand new and take the rental back. And so he just set up everything that they could, started expanding their network of insurance coverage. Went to Medicare, got all the licensure to do Medicare, started reaching into places where they'd never reached before. Not too long after this, Stark and a bunch of other regulations had come out, and so people were all scared to death about Medicare, and you're going to go to jail and stuff. And he worked through what was a violation, what wasn't. The anti-kickback stuff came out, Social Security Act. It was 1787, all these different things started coming out. He would navigate them and make sure that he was in compliance so they could build Medicare. What this gentleman did was build an extremely profitable, but on top of that, more importantly, very patient-focused in-house DemiPost program. He did it very well. If you go down to Kearney Mesa, it's essentially running the way he set it up 20-some-odd years ago. Still doing it pretty much the same way. So that gentleman, Mark Howard, left there after about 10 years and came to Breck. As he was a product manager and did a bunch of different things. He was a director of new product development because of his extensive athletic training background, his medical background. He was helping us go into new things and new technology and things we should be looking at. Managed the product development team for a while. And then, and it wasn't very long when he first got into the Breck building, he mentioned to the executives that, hey, I think there's something to what I did down there for Breck. A lot of groups were partnering. A lot of groups were getting into the billing game, stock and bill, doing a lot of different things, manufacturers, I mean. And Breck stayed way out of the fray, and we went a different route. And that route was to create what Mark created down here in San Diego at Breck, to partner with groups in helping them realize the improved patient care, the revenue, and basically increase control over what happens at your practice. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is the whole beginning of OPS, Orthopedic Practice Solutions. That's where it started, was here in San Diego with this gentleman. When he came here, shared with the team what he did here in San Diego, and it wasn't accepted right away, and it wasn't until 2005 did Breck formalize the program, and started hiring people to run it, and here we are today. All right, so I've got a few little housekeeping here. I've got a few slides that I've added to the slides in your book there. So in case some of you are retentive slide people like I am, you're like, hey, wait a minute, this is not matching what's in the book, and this is unacceptable. This is just absolutely unacceptable presentation material. material and style. By the way, my presentation style is horrible. I walk all around, I walk in front of the screen, I talk too loud, sometimes too soft, it's all over the map. But I hope you realize, and I'm not one of those really, really happy people because I don't like those people generally, but I get a little excited when I talk about this stuff, so hopefully you'll just allow me to have my energy and don't hate me for it, okay? Because I think what we can do is really separate what you're doing from the competition in your geography. So, slide Nazis, we got you taken care of. Got some of the slides you'll see up there now. So, I pose another question to you, maybe. What can we learn from this narrative? Anything that stood out in that story to you?
The patient-centered focus was the, I guess, driving force of it. I always thought that the force of the woman is the driver, but really it's about the patient. If you don't have a patient, it doesn't matter what you do, you're not going to have any money. Mm-hmm. And really word of mouth from good patient care really is better than any advertisement. You can be the best surgeon, but if your bedside manner is bad or your office staff is rude, you're all for nothing. So being patient-centered is I didn't know that that was the beginning approach or the catalyst to begin this.
Yep. And let me add to the narrative just a little bit. So once they started doing this, outcomes started to improve. Why? Because Mark and his staff, actually he pulled another athletic trainer away from the Chargers to help him run the program, to do the nitty-gritty, to do the day-to-day, and he's still there. This other gentleman is still at that practice still today. He's now a PA, but he's still been there all these years. But the outcomes improved, ladies and gentlemen. And word of mouth spread, and this place got busier and busier and bigger, hired more docs. They had a couple of docs that come in, that came in as interns and stayed, and they're still some of the more prominent surgeons here in San Diego. I mean, it just really became an amazing, amazing orthopedic clinic. And so what he put together and what he instituted worked. It worked very, very well. And it was patient-focused. Now, you and I all know that physician or physician practice may think about their patients, but we all know the bottom line does matter. The bottom line does matter. Controlling what goes on is also another big button. We'll talk about that. But you'll hear the theme around those three things a lot today, because that will help you sell it. How can, or why is it the best and how can we sell it? Resonating your messaging around those three things that it can deliver is a great, great start. So there's a nice foundation for you. Revenue, patient-focused, controlling what's going on. Controlling the product, controlling the outcomes, controlling the protocol, everything. Okay, good? Now they say that as you present, you get people's attention for about the first 7 minutes and then they're out. So we're past 7 minutes, but I still see some eye contact, so I think we're good, so I'll keep pushing forward. I gotta stop reading all these books about how to present. It messes with your mind. Any questions so far? Any thoughts? Any other answers to that question, by the way? I took a couple, but I didn't want to cut everybody off.
Not a question, but a comment. The beauty of this whole thing is because this is the outcome-based evidence information is here today. Because doctors and physicians are going to be judged on their clinical outcomes very, very shortly. And it's going to be dependent upon whether it's a successful practice or an unsuccessful practice. And it's the government who's going to be overseeing this. So I would think this would be a real big enhancement for any orthopedic program to come on, because if they can't get their reimbursement, they're not going to be in business very long.
Yeah. If they can't be compliant, if they don't know what it means to be compliant, there's a whole litany of things, not just the patient outcome,
right,
as Lynn points out, but there's a whole litany of things that if they can't capture and understand and put into practice and replicate with some efficiencies, yeah, they're not going to last. They probably won't last. Great comment. Thank you. Any other little learning tips or things that you found interesting in my little narrative and the little journey we took there? By the way, that's obviously a true story. I mean, I just didn't make that up. That's really, really how things started. So that kind of helps a little bit too. And folks, by and large, your opportunity to tell that story will present itself as you're selling. Because I think it's interesting. I think people want to know, well, how did this team you work on, or, you know, like Jeff could probably get posed the question, or a rep that's with him, how did this whole consulting thing get started? Well, it started back in San Diego. And I'll add to the narrative here in just a little bit, but it's an interesting industry story, and it's a true story. All right. So that narrative is what we, and I'm going to throw all my magic stuff out in the beginning here. That is what we're trying to do for these practices. We're trying to replicate what Mark did here in San Diego. You can all go home now. Just kidding. So that's what we're trying to do. Here's a couple things to help fill in the gaps of what we learned from this narrative. If you didn't pick up on it, I'll help you with a few lists here. Yes, and the slide is there in front of you. Why don't you look at my little pretty journey picture here we took together? Isn't that lovely? Little eye candy, keep you awake. All right. We got to understand outside vendors a little bit in our geography, don't we? We got to understand some of the third-party vendors that could be in our territories and what they do and don't do, service they do or don't provide, what products they represent, right? Got to understand a little bit of the orthopedic industry as it stands. Medicare compliance, big, big deal. Got to understand that. Patient-focused, there it is. Services, revenue, billing and coding becomes a big, big part of this. Contracts, what insurance contracts do they have available? And again, we're controlling outcomes, we're controlling charges. What do I mean by controlling charges? We'll get there. I have a slide for it, but let's talk about it right now. You all know what an L code is, right?
Yeah.
HCPCS code is another thing you'll hear it called. And that L code has a floor and a ceiling in all the states, correct?
Yes.
And doctors are buying the product for wholesale, and they're making money how?
Billing insurance for the
reimbursable.
The spread. The reimbursable. Yeah. That's what we're teaching them to do. Okay. You all passed Orthopedics 101. Congratulations. And I don't mean to make too much fun of that, but I just want to make sure we have a solid foundation upon which to build, right? Because I just have to know where you're at. Nothing personal. But controlling charges, for example, L3807, what does it reimburse?
In Florida, I think it's...
Can you give me ballpark?
211.
Are you saying $2.11?
No.
You're saying?
$211.
$211. What is an L3807?
It's a wrist splint.
Yeah. A wrist splint with the thumb spike head. Do you know what the 3908, which is without spike head, reimburses in Florida?
$70.
$70. So you're telling me that little, what is that? Inch and a half, 2 inches of material is worth $130.
It's gold.
Well,
it's even better because if you take the stays out, you're just an elastic arm for the
$10. Exactly. So, L3807 across most of the states, assuming we are custom fitting it, and we'll talk about that later, reimburses north of $200 across all 50 states. Folks, I'm here to tell you that's ludicrous. That's stupid. And if I'm a patient, and I see that on my bill, I get my EOB, I might make a phone call. Don't you think? Because what you might do is Google, what is this? What? Are you kidding me? I can get this for $100 on Amazon or whatever, wherever you may look, right? And there's a good chance that physician's office may hear about it. One of the things that we go in, our premise is because we want to be patient-focused, let's control some charges where we think it makes sense so that we don't tick off a patient. More often than not, I'd say most people on our team will tell practices, take the L3807 and bahar it, put it down a little bit, little spanglish it. Put it down just a little bit, or some, or a lot, whatever, just drop it. so it's not north of $200. I tell my groups, let's just put it at $100, $125 and call it a day. For $15 wholesale cost, I think if I bill out $125, let's say I get 70% of that, I'm still making some good money on putting on a wrist pump spiker, don't you think?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Those are the things that when we talk about control, it's not only in product selection and in your protocols and in your rehab sensibilities of what you want to do or not do with a prep patient, it's in the charges as well. So I just want to throw that out there.
Is it a good question of what you said in that example? You said if you're buying it for $15 and you're billing insurance for $125, why would you only get 70% of that? And this is me, I'm not, marketing, I don't know.
That's the Medicare allowable, but that doesn't mean that's what the private insurance is going to pay you. You have a contract to rate the fee.
Private,
yeah.
Not Medicare.
Would Medicare
pay you the full amount?
Yes. Yeah. Well, Medicare would pay you the full two, whatever.
Okay.
Well, they'll pay 80% of that. Sorry.
Patient
pays the 20%.
Yeah. Medicare,
oh, okay.
Patient
right.
has a coinsurance.
Yes. As you peel back the layers of insurance, trust me, it's a nightmare. No one understands it. No one likes it. But we think it should all pay for everything. It's a crazy thing. It's a crazy, crazy thing. Yeah. Now, if I've got a practice, and I have worked with groups that are 95% work comp and the rest are Medicare, do you think that we suggested him to drop down that charge? Heavens no. Heavens no. No, 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 no. 40% Medicare and 10 and some here and some of that, still maybe not. Because if your privates are just a small percentage of what you see, you won't hear any negative feedback to the charge, right? Medicare, 80%, a lot of them will have a secondary to cover their 20% out of pocket, right? And everything's good. Or somewhat good. Okay, I know that was a little segue, but I actually love doing little segues because I think it keeps us engaged and learning together. So those are some things that we learn out of here. And my last point, folks, it requires some work. It requires some effort. When those CPM machines came back to this practice, there in started a whole nother procedure, a whole nother list of things that had to be done, stripping off the pads, throwing them away, disinfecting the crud out of the thing, lubing it up, making sure it worked. These guys did that stuff. It was crazy for me to watch. When I was their sales rep, from 05 to 08, they were still doing the same stuff. Blew me away. And I'd go and pick up some of the CPM machines for them when Greg was still doing CPM machines and pick them up and bring them up to Greg to service them for him and drop them off for him. And it crazy to see these folks still do it. They were still renting cold therapy. And they'd grab the 500 pump, they would hang them. They had a special rack they made out of wood, and they'd hang them up so the neck of the pump was sitting up there, and they'd take the tube from a pad, and they'd cut the end off so they could click it in and drain the water out of the pump. And they'd sit there and drain them all and get all the water out of them, and they made them last forever, and they had boxes that you could tell were used forever and ever. It was amazing what they did there. Anyway, it does require some work and some effort. Nowadays, and I'd say, I can't think of one of my groups that does CPM machines. That's heavy service. Not hardly any of them that we consult with do them. Cold therapy, one-time sale, typically no rental. Because keeping track and cleaning them and all that stuff, a lot more work. But even on just the billing side and being compliant and making sure the documentation is correct and all the other things that go into this effort, there is work. Getting benefits for a patient and communicating those benefits to a patient. Key, very, very key, especially if it's for a larger ticket item. So there's work. And so I don't want you guys to walk away saying, oh man, this stuff's turnkey. Groups can pick this up and rock and roll, no problem. There is some work that goes into it. So I just want to make sure that's clear. All right. How we doing? So this is something I want you to key in on, and don't forget. Your goal is to just speak intelligently about what we have to offer. I don't expect you to remember the L3807s if you don't want to. I don't expect you to remember some of the little nuances and some of the details that I might dive into. Your goal as a sales rep is that. And I think that that can alleviate a little bit of pressure, because I think once you start seeing the immensity of this, I know when I first started learning about this and what we offered and what we did, I was like, holy cow, how am I going to learn all this stuff? There's no way. Way too much. Way too much. Don't expect that from you all. Do not have that expectation. This is my expectation. This is my expectation. Fair? Do you think that's fair? Okay, good. All right, with that said, I need to know who some of you are and what you do and who you're working with and all that. So we're going to let your brain relax for a minute. You're going to do a little intro for me, and then we'll jump back into some stuff. So Dan, I know you're in the marketing department.
Yeah, associate marketing manager. Yep.
And you've been here?
Since the beginning of July, and like right beginning of June.
Okay, cool. And you're just running through the training like everybody else?
Yeah, definitely still in the learning mode, absorbing mode right now. So I'll be focusing primarily on shoulder and ankle and some of the biomed integration.
Cool. Yeah. What's your background? How'd you jump into this?
Been in marketing for 10 years. I'd say most of it's been healthcare, pharmaceuticals, optical lenses, and medical device.
Cool. Good.
Dave. Titan Medical.
Titan. You Pat work with Pat. Very cool. You get to see Kate. You know Kevin Lord? Have you met Kevin Lord? Love me some Kalo. One of the guys on our team. Great guy. Great guy. I keep waiting to get out, invite out to his massive annual smoke app that they do. He gets a bunch of friends, and they all bring their smokers, and they smoke 4,000 pounds of meat and just sit there for 8 hours eating it. It sounds like a great time. Very cool. You got some OPS accounts there in the greater St. Louis area, which is awesome. I think one of them Kayla used to work at, or... By the way, most everyone on our team is an athletic trainer or a DME coordinator, or we pull them away, and yes, we'll talk about that too. Jay.
Yes, I work for the OrthoMotion distributorship, and that's in South Carolina.
Oh, okay, so your guy is?
Eric. I'm the head of the distributorship.
Yeah.
Blake Smith.
Blake, you're with Blake. Okay, that's right, Blake. Yeah, Eric Siever's your guy over there with yeah. These two guys. Yeah. Eric, love me some Eric Siever, man. What a great guy.
He's good.
That guy, I'm telling you folks, that guy walks into a clinic and he says, hey, we've got some service solutions. These are things we can do for you. This is what it's all about. They're like, you got a contract we can sign right now? I wish I was kidding. I wish I was freaking kidding. It is the truth.
It's scary bad.
and Brad Lee and Steve Paul are asking, they're like, Eric, what do you do? He's like, I just walk in and tell them what I can do for them. And they say, where's the contract? Am I joking?
No. I've seen it. He sells without selling.
He's crazy.
It is amazing. And I want to be Eric Siever when I grow up. Anyway.
A great story is Eric went to a clinic and the rep was like, man, this is, you know, we just need to bend some fences here. The rep didn't even want to go because he had heard that that they just were going to put kibosh on anything that had rag on. And so Eric was just going to go just to say hi. Walked out
of
the contract.
Let's come back to that when we get a little more.
He's a bit of a freak that way.
Yeah, craziness. Chris.
Chris Howard, and I'm a distributor rep in Georgia with Blake as well.
Okay.
And still really new, first month with Greg.
Wow.
My first month. Last 10 years, so I've worked for Joint Active Systems and Lance Medical.
Okay, so you've definitely been in the space.
I have.
Yeah. Good, which is nice.
You're doing a great job.
How's the fire hose water taste? Pretty good? Yeah, what's your background, Gene?
I've been 3 years. I basically got with Blake just fitting some bracing, and we kind of just grew, and now I do a little bit more for him and his distributorship and some other stuff.
Awesome, yeah, because things have changed over there in the last couple of years immensely, yeah. Awesome.
There's a pending... I think you guys are coming to Emory pretty soon, or maybe it's Eric. I'm pretty interested in that happening.
Yeah, Eric's got some great stuff going on in the Southeast. Yeah, some great stuff. Derek.
I'm in South Carolina as well, for the
Awesome.
I've been with them for a little over 6 months.
Okay.
We before that, I did 23 years at Merck.
Wow.
As a manager.
Wow.
Sold vaccines, medical devices, pills, kind of sold it all.
You've seen some stuff.
I've seen it change all for bad.
Just hanging on for dear life. Yeah, it's crazy, huh? Yeah, just in the 10 years I've been around this space, it's amazing. All right, who we got there?
That's not me.
I figured, but I wasn't. So, what's your name?
Ty Waddell. I work for RSW.
Okay.
And I'm out of Milwaukee, Wisconsin.
Oh, okay, awesome.
Yeah.
Awesome. Love me some Randy Wink. Good guy. Yeah, tells you like it is. You know where you stand with Mr. Wink.
Yeah.
Which is good for a boss.
Yeah.
Yeah. How long have you been doing this?
4 months almost.
All right. What'd you do before?
I just graduated from college.
Nice.
Yeah.
First job?
First real job. I worked as a physical therapist back before that.
Oh, okay. So you've been, was it in a clinical setting?
Yeah, clinical setting.
What practice, kind of practice? Was it ortho?
It was we were on our own. It was accelerated rehab.
Okay. So kind of your own physical therapy joint. Okay.
Yeah.
Cool. So you've seen what the rehab process is like.
Oh, yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
Very cool. Awesome. And what was the name again?
Kyle.
If I don't see the name tag, I'll feel lost. I just met you.
Shane, who are you? I'm at the tippy top of the Northeast. I'm in Virginia. Of course, work for Eric Siever and Justin Brooks and Jeff.
JB. Love me some JB.
Yeah, he's a cool guy. Yeah. Just started about a month ago. Started in August. Definitely a fire hose because I don't have necessarily a whole bunch of medical background. I was in sales and marketing and in the home building industry and in the identity management industry and stuff like that. But I'm loving it so far. It's great.
It's interesting. The OPS team, we hire by what you know, sometimes who you know, but a lot of times with what you bring to the table, your potential. We look for the master traits. Everyone know what those mean? Ask Mark Howard, the guy that started it. So we look for the master traits. So Shane must have the master traits, or else he wouldn't have gotten hired. So JB, you know his nickname, right? Do you know his nickname yet?
Decaf.
Well, besides that.
No, it's
AM Talk Radio.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah, definitely. I can see that.
You cannot shut that boy up. It's awesome.
He needs decaf.
I thought you were going to mention the. I guess I just found out that every time they go to the Georgia Bones, they have this like hotness contest, and there's always like this new and like
he'll
hot sauce, him. Like this Scoville scale, or whatever, and he just goes in and just kills it.
Yeah,
just like it's nothing.
Yeah, he's crazy.
Yeah,
it's because the 40,000 gallons of coffee he drinks a day has deadened any sensitivity to this stuff. No, he's a great guy. Super intelligent guy. Really, 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 really good. All right, who we got?
Phil.
Phil, how are you?
Good, doing well. I'm underneath Scott Blackwelder, Tri-State Orthopedic Products in Columbus, Ohio. I'm working right now with Don Cowell in that area. We kind of are working to kind of split the region up, and I've only been there for 6 months, so it's pretty new for me. But I have some really good teachers, especially underneath Don. He knows a lot.
Don's been around.
Well.
Don's been around. He's been with Breg, been with Scott, been with Breg, been with Scott, been with Breg, been with Scott. Yeah, he's been around. Good guy.
Right.
Scotty knows this stuff too. If he can calm down and take some time and train you, he's got the wealth of information.
Ask Phil if he's met Scott yet.
Have you met Scott yet?
I have not.
You haven't met Scott yet?
No.
But he's your boss.
Yes.
He is your boss. And you have not met the cat. What is his problem? Okay, would you email him?
I'll talk to Scott.
Will you?
He's so busy.
I don't care.
So many things.
You're a new employee. You should be, a little. There's got to be a little this, right? A little arm linking for just a step or two. You tell him I told him that, and so I've known Scott for many years, and my first sales meeting, this guy wins an award, and the last name Blackwelder is not like something that's just, uber,
common,
thank you. So when I met him, I said, you don't happen to have an uncle named Julius Blackwelder, do you? Or a relative named Julius Blackwelder. He's like, yeah, that's my uncle. I'm like, He was my scout leader when I lived out in Connecticut, so I know his uncle, crazy stuff. Anyway, small world. But when you're a black welder, it's just a small world. All right. Kevin.
I too know the black welders.
Good.
Ralph Black Welder and the whole gang. So Scott's my boss as well.
Have you met him?
Have I met who?
Scott.
Yeah. I've met him.
Good.
Not from his tribe.
Scott used to babysit his wife.
Yeah. They go way back.
So when you say you know some black welder, you know, okay, I got you. All right, cool.
Yeah.
And where are you at right now?
Cincinnati.
You're
so
in Cincinnati.
I'm right there with Scott.
Okay.
I've been with him for about 7 years.
Awesome.
And I'm just now getting out to training 101.
Dude, I've emailed with you, like,
I'm sure.
What's your last name?
K-O-C-H. Cook.
Dude, I've emailed you back and forth asking for stuff and price lists and things and stuff and stuff. Okay, nice to meet you.
You too.
Yeah, you're getting out of the office. Good for you.
Well, no, you might be thinking of Todd.
Well, no, I know there's Todd, but I know there's you too.
Yeah, I'm out of the office, but yeah, I just haven't had any break training. I mean, I've done cold therapy and the lower extremity when I came on, but that's kind of what I ran with, you know? So I know cold therapy, I know boots and night splints and all that stuff, but I just haven't had a lot of training on upper extremity.
Other stuff. Now. Good for you, man. Good stuff. Linda.
Linda White. I'm the National Director of Workers' Comp. I have about 13 years of orthopedic experience. Came from the dark side. And my purpose is to make sure we all know how to do the workers' comp piece.
Oh, you're going to be hearing from some OPS peeps.
Oh, I already have.
Yeah, Brian, I work for Brian, and he just sent out some stuff to our California folks that
yes.
You just sent him.
The PR too.
Yes. Okay. And I'm like, where has this been all relaxed? I didn't even know that existed.
It's already been mandated for many years, too. But
see, this is why we need some Linda.
Yeah.
We need us some Linda.
Yeah.
So excited.
Thank you.
Great to have you aboard.
I'm Max. Yeah, I'm Susan.
Zach?
Yes, I'm Zach.
I'm Zach.
You never know. No, anyway. Zach.
Zach Owen. I'm in Virginia. I'm in Ashland Medical.
And who's your?
Timmy Rose.
The Roaster.
The Rose. Everybody knows him, a Timmy Rose story.
Oh, yeah. That boy does not go quietly.
No.
Or come quietly, or is anything quietly. When Tim's around, you know.
Yeah.
Unless it's the next morning. Then he might be quiet for a little bit. But then he's
right.
Around again.
It's funny because when we walked into the national meeting, you walk in there and everybody's like, who are you with? I'm like, who's that? I'm like, where's Tim? Where's Tim? I gotta see him. And he walks in, and I mean, he's like a celebrity. He's on the phone. He's like, Timbo! You know, everybody at the bar is like yelling at him. And don't see him for like 3 hours. He comes back, and he's just—he's so much fun.
He's a good guy, man. He can sell this stuff.
My gosh, he's amazing in the room. Amazing.
He's good.
I just set up meetings with him. Tim, please make it down here this week. We got a big meeting. All right, but I gotta be back by 6. So he'll come down and just get some talking. Next thing you know, he's just got a whole night.
It's awesome. Good stuff. Welcome.
Thank you.
Susan.
I'm Susan Griegel, and I'm the National Director of Managed Care and Medicaid. So Linda has work comp, and I have everything else. And I've been in this industry probably about 20 years.
Wow. Yeah. Awesome. Again, so excited to have you aboard.
Thanks.
We lack some expertise in a few areas, and we're getting better at it. With these hires, which is good stuff. Okay, should we turn our brains back on? Ready to go? All right, let's see where we're at here. Let's move along. Let's get cracking. So, I want to throw this out here. We're doing some progressionary learning, line upon line, precept upon precept. A little quote I heard one time. So, we're just taking it step by step here. All right, and so come along with me as far as you can, and I'll take it. Because remember, if you can speak intelligently about business solutions, that's what I'm looking for. But that's kind of my thought process here. We've got a lot of things that come under the business solution team umbrella. And we're going to narrow down our focus just a little bit today. And we're going to spend most of our time on our OrthoSelect consulting and our vision inventory management, DemiPost management system, okay? We do have stock and bill. We do have hospital stock and bill. We do have the Breg billing through the Breg's claim system. We've got some PT consulting. We've even added a couple other things that I didn't even put on the slide. But we've got a number of things that we can talk about that come under our umbrella, but for time's sake, for fire hose and safety of your brain, we're just going to really focus on the top two, okay? We do have the others. They are available. As you know, we acquired Biomet not too long ago, and that really put us into the stock and bill world because Greg was never a player there. Never was a player there. We're still learning some stuff. I think we've got a lot of things ironed out. I think we've got to where we can get to. But if you need that, pull it out and fire it, right? You've got that in your arsenal. To differentiate yourself, we really think the top two are going to really do it for you and allow you to sell product more effectively and abundantly. But do know that we have the others. The hospital stock and bill, we're partnering with a group that has some expertise in that area until we get something that is better or we can replicate it or something, but we've got a partner there that's really good. The reg billing, if you're associated with us at all, you know that we can take scripts and take care of stuff when it goes towards your quotas and all that good stuff and you rock and roll, right? And the PT consulting, just know that it's there. I'm not going to touch on it, but just know that it's there. If you run across somebody that could use some PT help, we've got some outlets. Some of the regions are focusing in a little more on that. I know on the West Coast we're not. We're kind of letting that lie because we're still trying to just grow like Eric Sieber grew, so that's what we're doing. So I just kind of wanted to point that out. There's a lot of things that come under the umbrella. We're going to really focus on the top two, okay? And I put this slide together, and this really is just a summary. I know you don't do summaries in the middle of a presentation, but I really kind of wanted to just get the nuts and bolts out right up front so that if questions come up, if things don't make sense, you've got another foundation to build upon. So we really want to understand the orthopedic industry. We want to, and these are things that I think you should try to come away learning. And if you don't today, this could be your homework. Okay? This could be your homework. But know your basic L codes, your HCPCS codes in this space. When I first started selling, people would say, oh, hey, Ryan, what's the L code on that ankle brace? I don't know. Who cares? It's a great one. Look at all the features and benefits. And look how soft and plush this is. And look how this does that. And they're like, hey, you're walking boot. What's the L code on that? I'm like, I don't know, but look at the bottom and how it rocks and the thing and how quick it is to strap in the thing and it's better and it's this and it's that and the slingshot too, which I'll go, I don't know, but look at the thing and the padding and the comfort and the air mesh and the ooh and the wicking blue stuff and you know. And after a little while I was like, okay, Ryan, let's see, you keep getting asked what the L codes are for these products. Perhaps you should learn them. So don't make a mistake I did. Don't let 4 or 5 months go by. Learn them. Learn what they are. And simply, we have a document on the Inner Circle that has them all. Print that out and just carry it around with you if you need to. Just start quizzing yourself. Learn the L codes for our products. It's really important. Do you want to go a little step further, which I think you should? Know you're allowable for that L code. And I can get you that information if you'd like. Familiarize yourself with the 30 supplier standards. Why do I need to know the supplier standards? Because it will open up a selling opportunity for you. So I thought I'd print them for you. Some of them apply to a physician's office. Some of them don't. Did you know that all physician offices that are with Medicare need to have their hours posted on the door, and if they don't, that's a problema? It's a big time problema. Did you know that?
Yes.
So if you walk into a clinic and they say, yo, we don't need consulting, we got it wired. You don't even see hours on the door? You know, just notice. Did you know they're supposed to have a complaint resolution process program? There's a whole litany of things that some groups don't know that they need to have, and the 30 supplier standards laid out. So, add to your homework. Familiarize yourself with those because it can present selling opportunities, and it really sells around what you've heard, being better at compliance or get compliant. Either one. All right. Do you like me giving you all the good stuff right up front? Is this helpful? I hope so. student of the game. You've been learning about student of the game. The same principles apply here. Same principles apply here. Zach, sell me the free runner.
And the free runner is a great race. Just came out on the market, and we just want to show it to you. It's made of a revolutionary material nobody else has, and it has a hinge at 30 degrees of extension that actually keeps the patella in place all the way through. So, hey, it's a great race.
Awesome. So, did he know that I was interested in that?
Nope.
Did I have a need? Do I see patients that have patellofemoral issues? Do I have athletic people that mount track? Do I have a need? Now, I'm kind of busting on him a little bit, right? Because I just completely set him up.
Yeah.
But, same concept, folks. You have got to be able to speak intelligently, remember our goal, about service solutions to be able to go in and sell it. And it's going to require, on your end, asking good questions, knowing some supplier standards, knowing a few things, so you can ask these intelligent questions, vet out what they may or may not be doing correctly, because you're not selling features and benefits, which you did a great job, by the way. You're selling solutions. And to sell a solution, what do you have to uncover?
Problems.
Bingo. There's your mindset for the next little while. That is the mindset we need. All right, so student of the game. So key, because you've got to know how they're taking care of bracing and DME. Right? What are they doing? How are they taking care of it? Do they script it out because it's a pain and they believe the vendor that they can't make money doing it? Or they believe the stock and bill company that they can't make money doing it, so they give it all the money to the stock and bill company. What are they doing? How are they taking care of it? So student of the game stuff, key. You want to be familiar with documentation. Don't trip on that. Just let it marinate, okay? Just let it marinate. Proof of delivery, detailed written order. So if you want to jot those down, you'll know what those are. And there are a lot of dictation requirements as well. A lot of dictation requirements. We've got this whole split code. Now it's more dictation requirements. Don't trip out on that. Let it marinate. Just let it soak. And just know that you'll get there at some point. Remember, this is really progressionary. This is very, very progressionary, folks, in how I'm laying it on the slide and how you should learn about it as you do your homework. Familiarize yourself with billing and see the big picture of implementation. When I say that, think of the narrative. Getting a group to be able to do that is what we're trying to implement, okay? Here's the big picture, folks, and I put this in your slide deck that I handed you as well. How does this happen? I'm the physician. I walk out of my exam room. I need a walking boot in room 2. Susan, make it happen. Boom, and I'm out. Where am I going?
Next patient.
Next patient. I might grab my little dragon thing, but I'm done.
Hopefully you wash your hands.
Right, I'm out. My coffee, little dragon, little dictation drop down, put a couple things in real quick, and I'm in room 3. Done. But that patient that just, you know, walked off the curb and has a severe high ankle sprain needs some attention. And the doctor said, boom, take care of it. We want a happy patient. We want a billing claim sent, right? Because we don't want to just buy a boot and let the revenue walk out and the cost of the brace. Double whammy. You see that? Double whammy. Because I paid $30 for it and I could have made whatever on it. I want the product allocated as dispensed so I can keep track of things. Remember, we talked about inventory. And I got to have some medical records of what happened. I got to have some documentation of that transaction. Folks, this does not happen in the blink of an eye, but this is what we're talking about. So when I see the big picture of implementation, this is what we're trying to get groups to see how to do. To do it well, do it on with their patient as the focus, and if they do it well, they do it efficiently. Do you know there's something there's some principle that says when you repeat something, you just get better at it. Not that the task has become easier, but because of the repetition, it just becomes... you just become better and quicker and faster at it. We're creating efficiencies here. Okay. So this goes into some of the older slide that Mike printed out. But I really like to look at things of what, so what, and now what. That's kind of my presenting style. So we're going to be selling service solutions, and that's what we're going to be focusing on. We talked about this, right? We talked about this. To provide a solution, you must solve a problem. We need to identify problems. So I want get your problem thinking caps on, folks. What problems do you encounter on a day-to-day basis? And those of you that aren't reps, just as employees or OPS folks, business solutions, marketing managers, associate marketing, whatever. What challenges do you face in the day-to-day work?
Means differentiating yourself.